Hello, my lovely friends. My name is Ava, and today we're going to be talking about all of the books that I read in the later half of July. In the second half of July, I ended up reading about 16 books, and then I do have a DNF or two to mention also. If you want to know all the books that I read at the beginning of July, the first half of the month, I'll leave my mid-month wrap-up link down below for you. The first book that I ended up reading in the later half of July is The Alien's Ransom by Ella Maven. I've heard great things about Ella Maven in a lot of my alien romance videos. I get some comments saying, you need to try out Ella Maven, you need to try out her books. So I finally did. I think every single book in this series is on AnyPlay. This is the first book in the Draxonian Warrior series, and I do want to continue on. So I look forward to having like a whole entire alien romance series available for me to listen to on AnyPlay. This is definitely a unique romance. It's basically like an alien romance, but it's also a motorcycle club. Our alien guys, a part of this series, are all in a motorcycle club on this alien planet, but it's not like motorcycles. It's like the alien equivalent to that. So they're not exactly like our type of motorcycles, but they're essentially in a biker gang, you know? They basically come across these group of women who have been taken off of Earth, and they're gonna save them. One of the women and one of the motorcycle alien men end up meeting, and they are fated mates. And that's all I really want to say about this one. That's kind of how the rest of the books are going to go, I think. This was a really fun read. I love just reading new alien romance authors, so I'll definitely check out more Ella Maven. Let me know down below if you've read Ella Maven, what your favorite series is by her. Cause this one was fine. It was 3.5 stars. There were points that I was just like cringing because of like the made up alien curse words were just like, not it for me. Like, I didn't feel like it flowed organically. It just like made me cringe. You know what I mean? I don't really know how to describe it. But I do think I will continue on with the series. And if I don't love book two, I might stop there. But for tropes for this one, it's an alien romance, there's fated mates, and there is a language barrier throughout the majority of this book. Again, I gave this book 3.5 out of 5 stars. Next is a little novella. I decided to pick up The Ogre's Pet by Cassandra Cross. I just needed a short read because whenever I'm feeling slumpy, I pick up a novella. So I was feeling slumpy, so let's just pick up a monster romance novella. Basically, our heroine runs into the woods that she's been warned her whole life not to go into because there are creatures in it, basically. And she gets taken by this giant ogre. So size difference galore in here. Like, I think he can hold her in his hand. So it's just a short monster romance novella filled with size difference. I gave it 3 stars. It gave what it needed to give, you know, with like needing a palate cleanser. So then I picked up For the Love of the Gods by Rory L. Scott. This is the first book in the Tempt the Gods series. And this is definitely a unique romance. If you love Roman and Greek mythology, I definitely recommend this book. I just got the arc of book two. So that one's gonna come out fairly soon. So you can possibly read book one and then immediately jump into book two if you want to. I believe this series is about Greek and then Roman gods marrying and getting together. So in this one, you have Lord Pluto and Lady Hades getting married. Even though they don't want to, because this is definitely enemies to lovers. They do not like each other, but the fates have deemed it so. They said that they're gonna get married, so they have to get married. They don't really get along, and their relationship grows even worse when Rose's, who's Lady Hades, her father and brother end up dying, and Dominic and a lot of other people out in the world believe that she's the one who killed them. He hates her for killing his best friend, because her brother was best friend. So how are the two going to be married to each other if they despise each other? So definitely a unique romance. Again, if you like Greek and Roman mythology, I definitely recommend this book. I will say I'm not that well versed in it. I think the only things I know are from what I read in the Percy Jackson series in middle school. And so there were times in here I was very lost. There were a lot of gods, and I'm not familiar with Roman mythology whatsoever. So there were just gods' names being talked about, and I was like, I don't know who that is. I did feel like there was a lack of world building in that aspect because I am not well versed in Greek and Roman mythology. And I felt like this book was geared towards someone who already knew about all that, and I just didn't. But maybe that was just a me thing. And maybe I'm just too dumb to like understand what some things are that are going on. I do have a memorable quote in this one. Revenge is nothing compared to you. Nothing makes this. He tapped the knife over his heart. Beat, except for you. and I can't let you die because you'll be taking down both of us. Live with me, Rose. A trigger warning's in here for death, grief over losing a family member, and bullying. Tropes, brother's best friend, enemies to lovers, fated mates. It's on Kindle Unlimited. The couple is married. It's a mythological romance. You have the That's My Wife line. Okay. And Torture and Die. I gave this book 4 out of 5 stars. Oh my gosh. Then I read Taken to Nobu by Elizabeth Stevens. I love this book. This was a buddy read with Tiff over at Tiff Talks Pages or Neverland Pixie on Instagram. And this is the second book in the Severy Mates series, which is an alien romance series that Tiff and I just adore. And oh my gosh, this is definitely a series you do need to read in order, because you meet the heroine of this book, Kiki, in book one, and you'd be kind of a little bit lost as to what's going on in this book if you didn't read book one. So please read these books in order. You can read them out of order if you want to, but I think like you wouldn't love this book as much as you're supposed to if you didn't read book one. I really loved book one, but book two, Taken to Nobu, just like blew book one out of the water for me. This is fantastic. It takes place directly after book one, Taken to Varaxia, but on a different planet called Nobu. And book one in the series, the hero of book two is best friends with a guy from book one. Anyway, he glimpses Kiki on this slave moon that they do not approve of. They are trying to figure out what's going on this moon, as you read in book one, and he takes one glimpse at Kiki and knows that that is his fated mate. But in book one, Kiki gets very, very, very injured, almost dies, and so he ends up taking his fated mate to his planet with him and healing her there. So this is basically what happens after that, when she gets woken up from being in stasis, from being healed. And she is getting thrown into this ritual of sorts, doesn't know what's going on, is absolutely terrified because on the moon she was essayed a lot by some aliens. And so this is her journey of like loving herself again, but then also realizing like not every alien she comes across is like the one who abused her. Both of these characters were just everything to me. I loved Kiki, I loved the hero, I loved how patient and kind he was. This book has a very high emphasis on consent, and I loved it. And the hero knows that something is going on with Kiki and just is like, no, we're not gonna do anything because I feel like something is wrong. Even though you're not telling me something is wrong, I know something is wrong, and I would never want to taint our relationship in that way. I just love seeing Kiki's growth. She grew so much in this book, and I loved it. Elizabeth Stevens, fantastic, fantastic. Trigger warnings in this one for trauma from sexual assault, death, blood, fighting, like physically fighting with somebody. Tropes, alien romance, a tortured heroine, dual narration. The audiobook in here is fantastic. Like the dual narration here, oh, so good. It's emotional, it has fated mates, the hero falls first, you have a warrior woman, it's on Kindle Unlimited, never been kissed hero, no third act breakup, soulmates, innocent hero, and the who did this to you trope. I also really recommend this book if you love Ice Planet Barbarians, because it has the icy planet like IPB does, so you can look forward to that. I gave this book 5 out of 5 stars. I loved it. I can't wait to read more. Then I will just mention, I didn't read all these back to back, but I'll just mention them now. I did my reread for the Summer of Tessa Day read along for all of the Girl Meets Duke series books that are out. So The Duchess Steel is a marriage of convenience. Love 5 stars. I love this one so much. If you need to get into historical romances and you want to, pick this series up. Like, it's the creme de la creme, okay? Then book two is The Governess Game, which is a governess romance with kids that are absolutely hilarious to die for. I adore them. 5 stars. And then the last one that's currently out is The Wallflower Wager. Our hero and heroine are next door neighbors, and the heroine owns a lot of pets, and the hero's gonna help her find homes for all of them. It's so stinking cute. It's Grumpy Sunshine to the max. I love it. I love the series so much. Gave all of them 5 stars. I had so much fun buddy reading all these books with my friends. I loved rereading these. If you just need to feel good and have a good laugh, like, these books are like rom-coms, but in historical form. Like, they're everything. Then I read The Viking She Would Have Married by Lucy Morris. I'm trying to read one physical book a month. This was that book for me. So Lucy Morris is the queen of Viking romances to me. She writes amazing, very realistic Viking romances. I love them. So this is her third book. She's been so kind and sending me her books. And so I love you, Lucy, I love you. But this one is about a shield maiden who is kind of like a Viking warrior woman. And this is her second chance romance with the guy who was like her first in every way possible. I think her name is pronounced Valda. She is in need of work to help provide for her mother and her sisters. And she ends up getting a job on like a voyage, but doesn't expect her ex to be there. They haven't seen each other in years. He's actually the captain of this ship. And so they have to be in close proximity on this ship for months on end. And they both think the other person is at fault for why their relationship ended. And they haven't stopped thinking about each other since their relationship ended. I loved how the hero just became a total softie for Valda. And just seeing the heroine grow as a person, I really, really appreciate that as well. I also felt like Lucy Morris did a lot of research going into this one, because it was so cool, like, reading about these Vikings going on voyages that took months to take. There is the miscommunication trope in here. That's why this one isn't my favorite. It's gonna be getting 4 stars from me, but I really liked it regardless. For tropes in this one, you have forced proximity, it's historical, second chance, Vikings, and a warrior woman. Again, I gave this book 4 to 5 stars. I reloaded into my NetGalley after years of not being on it, because NetGalley would stress me out, because I am primarily an audiobook listener, and a lot of these books that I was approved for don't have audios, and I just got overwhelmed with how many I had to read by a certain date, and I wasn't in the mood to read them. Anyway, okay, I decided to log back into my NetGalley, and there were books on my shelf that I still have not reviewed yet, and they've been there for quite a while. So one of them was Battle Royal by Lucy Parker, and I was like, you know what, I think the audiobook is on my Libby. It was, so I downloaded it, and I was like, I think I'm just going to get the audios for these books that I have on my shelf on NetGalley and review them now so I can possibly get my score up. I have always been excited to read this one because it deals with baking, and if y'all know me, I love baking. This book reminded me of having like Great British Baking Show vibes, and I love that show. Sylvie and Dominic met when Sylvie was one of the contestants on this Great British Baking Show of sorts, and Dominic was one of the judges, and her cake basically exploded on him, and it became like a viral sensation, and that's like their first meeting. But it's been 4 years since then. Sylvie now owns her own bakery, and it's across the street from Dominic's. And Sylvie has been invited back to the show, but to be a judge alongside Dominic instead. And the two of them don't really get along. They're total opposites. He likes decorating like white, pristine cakes, and she goes for funky, fun, quirky cakes. Then on top of that, the two of them get roped into a competition of sorts. They find out that the crown princess of the country is getting married. They just announced their engagement, so they really want to make their wedding cake. So they're both competing to see who could make their wedding cake. This was such a fun read. I loved all the baking elements. As someone who loves baking, like, that just put a huge smile on my face. Was reading about the love of baking and just all the different baking scenes and the concoctions and things they were making in here. I love the fact that they have like rivaling businesses, but they were also rivaling in more than just that way, which is so fun. But then under the surface, like, they become fans of each other and each other's desserts. Like, I love it. I will say though, there was a lot going on in this book, so it gave me like whiplash at times. I think a few things possibly needed to get taken out. Like, there was a lot, like the caking, competing against each other, the rivaling businesses, and then they're also on this baking show. I don't necessarily think there needed to be the baking show element, in all honesty. So, not my favorite part of the book, but it definitely sparked my sweet tooth while reading. I wanted to bake everything under the sun while reading this book. For tropes for this one, you have baking. It's a British book, definitely British. Brooding hero, a foodie romance, great banter, grumpy sunshine, rivals to lovers, an older couple. So the couple is not in their 20s, like, they're older than that, so they're older couple compared to most romances, you know what I mean? Opposites attract, and there's a reality show aspect. I gave this book 4 out of 5 stars. My DNF for the later half of the month is Ride Hard by Laura Kay. I just wanted to pick up another Laura Kay book because I love Hearts and Darkness so much. That's one where the two characters meet on an elevator, but without seeing each other because the power goes out and they're stuck in the elevator together, but they don't know what the other person looks like, and they end up like staying there for hours and like falling for each other. I love that book so much. And so I was like, I need to pick up another Laura Kay. Saw that she had a motorcycle club romance and picked it up. I don't think this is for me. This book was written in 2016. And it reads like it was written in like 2012. You know what I mean? Like, it gives me those like cringy writing 2012 vibes. Like, not my speed. I also just didn't care about the two main characters at all. I didn't like either of them. And I got a few chapters in and I was like, I'm not gonna waste my time. So I DNF'd it. Another foodie romance is Draco by Layla Faye. You wouldn't think that a dragon shifter romance is a foodie romance, but it is. And it was so cool. I love how Layla Faye put that in this book. Jo is a human woman that just has the worst luck on the planet. She doesn't know this, but she's actually cursed. But then she gets a slight glimpse of luck when she gets hired at this restaurant called Dragon's Lair. The restaurant is owned by renowned chef Draco. And it isn't until Draco hires her that Jo knows about dragons and that Draco is a dragon shifter. And he needs Jo's help to procure some magical ingredients for his restaurant. I had so much fun reading this. I always have fun reading this author's romances, and I love the fact that Draco was inspired by Gordon Ramsay. Like in the author's note, Layla Faye was like saying thank you to Gordon Ramsay for inspiring her to write Draco. So he definitely has those like grumpy chef vibes, which I loved. If you want an entertaining like chef grumpy monster romance, definitely pick this one up. For tropes, you have chef, brooding hero, dragon shifter, Kindle Unlimited, monster romance, paranormal, magical, and there are shifters. I gave this one 4 out of 5 stars. One of my favorites from the month is Catch and Cradle by Katya Rose. This is a sapphic college sport romance. They both play lacrosse. Becca and Hope are teammates on the UNS women's lacrosse team. Becca is actually the team captain. On this team, there is a very, very set in stone rule about not dating your teammates. But the two of them cannot stop thinking about each other. Like they cannot. They want to break the rules so bad. I just love seeing these two fall in love. It was so beautiful to me. I loved it. It was so cute. I love how inclusive this book was too, in many different ways. Like I wish more books were as inclusive as this one. I adored the dyslexia representation. Hope has dyslexia, and I loved her talking about what she does to help with her in college. Like I bet a lot of people who have dyslexia feel very discouraged going to school, especially going to school like college, because they think it could be difficult for them. So I love how Hope in here, like she goes through all the motions. She talks about all of her feelings, like I didn't want to go to school and then I realized I can do this. And then she talks about all the accommodations she's made for herself to help her succeed. Like, and her friends are all on board, her roommates, her friends, like they'll even like read certain passages out loud to her on recording so she can listen to them instead of physically reading it. And in return, like she'll bake them treats or something like that. Like I just loved seeing that representation in a book. Like I thought the representation was done so well. I also loved reading about Hope's like growth and her confidence. It was beautiful to read about. Becca, the captain of the team, I really related to because of her feelings about like college. Like she's almost a senior and she doesn't feel the passion anymore for what she majored in, like at all. She's trying to figure out what she wants to do with the rest of her life and she feels lost. I'm like, been there, done that, girl. Been there, done that. I'm praying and hoping that there are books about the side characters in here. They were fantastic as well. Turquoise in here for ableism. And like I said before, there is a representation for dyslexia. Tropes, it's set in Canada. That's a new trope of mine. So set in Canada, it's character driven, college romance, forbidden, there's a groveling scene, pining, it's sapphic, it's a sports romance, and they are teammates. I gave this book 4.5 out of 5 stars. I read an arc for Burned Dreams by Neva Altaj. This is her recent release in the Perfectly Imperfect series, book number 7. I was so excited to pick this one up. I was so excited to even read the blurb for this one because it's a bodyguard romance and I am a total sucker for bodyguard romances. This one's about Alessandro and Ravenna. Alessandro is hired to be Ravenna's bodyguard. Her husband is a very controlling mafia man and needs a bodyguard to follow his wife 24/7. Alessandro sees this as the perfect opportunity to get revenge on the man who murdered his wife years ago. So he plans on basically taking an eye for an eye. This man killed my wife, I'm gonna go kill his wife and then kill him afterwards. But what Alessandro does not expect is for Ravenna to not be in that marriage willingly. She is getting abused by her husband every single day and he ends up developing this soft spot for this woman and then falling in love with her. So his plans kind of get ruined. I love bodyguard romances, so a friggin' plus for that trope in this book. It just adds a level of forbiddenness to the main characters and the fact that she was also married the whole time and like the tension and angst between the two. 10 out of 10 recommend. I just wanted a little bit more towards the middle about like them actually falling in love with each other. I felt like that was a little bit lacking. I just wanted more. So it's not a full 5 stars for me. This is one of the darker books in the series. I feel like Neva is just getting darker and darker as the series goes on. So please beware of trigger warnings in here for domestic violence and abuse, sexual assault, guns, bombs, murder, mention of a deceased spouse, torture, and gore. Memorable quotes. Okay, let me pick one of them. My feelings for Ravenna Pisano don't resemble a forest dream. They're a freaking waterfall. Unexpected, ferocious passion, desire, and beautiful madness. I crave her more than a condemned man wanting her next breath. Tropes, assassin turned lover, bodyguard, cheating, tortured heroine, forbidden, mafia, no third act breakup, a possessive hero. The revenge plotline is in here. You have a tatted hero, touch her and die, and he definitely says in here who did this to you. I gave this book 4 out of 5 stars. I read a short little novella again to cleanse the palate. I picked up Ear Candy by Cassie Mint. My go-tos for novellas are definitely Cassie Mint or Jessica Kane. So this is just a short little read about an assistant and boss falling for each other. He narrates like very hot audiobooks and she's like in love with his voice. She's his assistant and it's about them finally revealing their feelings for each other after a lot of pining. It was an okay read. I felt like they fell for each other before the book like even started, so you didn't really get to see them fall in love with each other, which is one of the main reasons why I love romance books. I want to see characters fall in love. I felt like that happened before the book started, but I love the fact that the hero was an audiobook narrator. I loved that. I gave this book 3 stars. Next, I have Northern Stars by Brittany Cherry, the last book in her Compass series. I am trying to read all of Brittany Cherry's backlist, so I'm fairly close. I'm fairly close. I finally have a whole entire series like done with now. This book takes place in 2 different timelines. You have part one and then part two. Part one, our 2 main characters, Aiden and Haley, are kids. They grew up living next door to each other and they are each other's best friend. And when they are in high school, they end up finally revealing their pent up feelings that they've had for one another and they fall in love. At the end of part one, something happens to rip them apart and they haven't seen each other in I think 5 years. And part two is what happens when they come back together. He comes back to their small town after becoming a giant celebrity, a giant actor in Hollywood. And he comes back to visit the small town and him and Haley bump into each other again. I love the dynamic between these two characters. It was everything I love, like childhood friends to lovers. This one read as like childhood enemies, because they don't really get along. Like they banter a lot as kids, but then they become best friends. And then it's lovers. And then it's like acquaintances kind of, or like you're out of my life situation. And then it's back to lovers. It's a long journey, okay? This wasn't my favorite in the series, but I really appreciated the story that Brittany told. I also just love the ending because we get to see all the couples in this series like come together at the end, which I love when authors do that in series, like making all the characters come together in the last book. There are heavy trigger warnings in here for cyberbullying, bullying, fat phobia, and disordered eating. So take care of yourself. If those things are at all triggering to you, I don't recommend picking this book up. I had to stop the audiobook a few times because it was a lot of times. Representation here for interracial romance and plus size representation. Tropes, you have a celebrity hero, childhood friends, friends to lovers, it's a second chance, and they are neighbors. I gave this book 4 out of 5 stars. And the last book that I have to talk about is Falling for the Manny by Kayla Nicole. I believe this is an author duo, if I'm not mistaken, but I definitely picked this one up because it is a nanny romance, but it's a manny romance because the man is the nanny in this situation. So our heroine in here, I love the fact that she's a billionaire heroine. You never read really about billionaire heroines, so I love that part in here. But she needs a new nanny for, I think, like 6-year-old kid. Her and her husband recently went through a divorce and she needs more help around the house. She doesn't know it yet, but her ex-husband ends up hiring the hero of this book. I think his name's Callum, because he wants Callum to figure out how he can win his wife back. And so the whole time Callum's like, sure, I'll get this amazing job as a favor for the dad. I'll just like figure out a way to woo his wife back, like no problem. But then he realizes like Thad was lying and it was not as simple as that. Like Thad is not a good partner in life really to the heroine. So he's like, oh no, like I'm not helping this dude. I can't help this dude. And then he ends up falling for her instead. This was fine. I ended up skimming like 50% on. I skimmed it because I just wasn't really feeling it. And there were some things I was not okay with. The hero and the heroine end up getting in like a fight, if you will, after she figures out that Thad like hired Callum to do this. And Callum literally says like, I didn't really do anything though. Like once I fell in love with you and your kid, like I haven't really done anything. And the heroine just like goes off on him and he says some not great things back. And I've said this before and I'll say it again. If you say hurtful things out loud to somebody, like I am very hard to forgive, like to forgive you. Like you said those things. They came out of your mouth. You were thinking them. Like, no. So, not my favorite, really, unfortunately, which is unfortunate because I loved one of the authors is Kayla Gross, who wrote Rein Me In, which is a cowboy romance I love. I didn't really care for this one. So I think I'm gonna give it like 2.5 stars. Well, there you have it. Those are all of the books that I read in the later half of July. Let me know down below if you've read any of these books or if you plan to. And if you don't feel like commenting any of those things, you can leave me a star emoji in the comment section down below. But anyways, thank y'all so much for watching. I will see y'all soon in my next one. Bye y'all.